In this video tutorial, we will design a small database for an archaeological site, or actually we have in mind to model multiple archaeological sites, but in the end, within our course, we will only have one site here. Still, we create a table structure that includes the possibility of multiple sites. And this is the structure that we came, decided on. So we have sites, several graves that have that can depend to one site. One site can have multiple graves, and within the graves we have individuals, artifacts, and C14 dates. And for individuals we have several attributes. Some of them, like sex and age, will be modeled in lookup tables. So we define certain ranges, value ranges there that can only be selected later on. And the same is true for artifacts, where we have types and materials that also will be filled within the database later on with using lookup tables. And several other attributes that we will now produce. And this is also already the diagram including the primary key here. So we decided that we have a specific primary key as an ID field that is an auto value. Okay, let's start from scratch, and let's see if we can do it like that. Oh, that might be difficult to read, so I will go back and forth between the fields here. Okay, we start with the sites table, and to make a new table, we could either use an assistant, but this doesn't make much sense for us, because archaeology is usually not included into the assistant examples. So we start with here from scratch, and this opens up. Oh, okay. No, we don't want to use start creating a view. We actually want to have a new table. So let's start with here. In English, there's new table, neuer Tabellenentwurf in German. We click on that, and now you see here the form for designing, structuring your table data. And when we look back here, we wanted to have an ID, a name, which I marked here as string, and latitude and longitude as floats. So this is a whole number, string is somehow a text, shorter or longer. String usually represents shorter ones, and floats are broken numbers or numbers with a decimal separator, and so not a natural number. Okay, these are the fields that we need, and we just will start entering them. So I set ID, and I just go through this now, name, lat, and long. Now we have the different fields here as names, and now we have to define the type of these fields. So ID should be an integer field, and it should be an auto value. So with this we get an automatic increasing value that serves for us as primary key. With that we have that already. Name should be, I said string, but in LibreOffice we have only the possibility to use text here, and that's fine. So we want to have a varchar text here, and the default length of 100 is fine for us. And latitude and longitude should be floats, so I select float here, and that's fine. So with that we have our first table set up, and I can save this, and I call this sites, and now I can close this down and open the sites table. And it opens like this, so we have the name field, lat and long, and I could immediately start typing something in here. In Skorvice, for example, and some fantasy coordinates. And also these coordinates are float, so I can add decimals. Keep in mind that when you use an Anglo-American language setting for your decimals, you might have to use the dot as decimal separator, and if it's the other way around, you can use the, you have to use the comma here. Okay, now I can save my changes and start getting to the next one, and let's have the same example like we had in the course, Winsingen, and also some fantasy coordinates here, and we have our next site here. Fine. We'll later on see how we can do this using forms, probably not for the sites table, but for the other tables. And but now you can see we started designing a table, and then we can directly enter some data here. So our structure was actually more complicated. We not only have sites, but also we have graphs and several other things. I now will set up the graphs table. So again, I'd like to have a new table here, and again should have ID, and this time I go directly to integer and say that it should be an outer value. And the next thing was site ID, which will connect this graphs or the individual graphs to individual sites. This also should be an integer. And then we had graph number, which originally was designed as string, but we decided in the course that we changed that to an integer also. So graph number integer, graph number integer. Then we have the depth, the length, and the width of the burial. Depth, length, and width. And all of these should be floats. Come on, float, and here too a float. And then there is construction. Construction serves here as kind of command field, so we can put there more information in construction. This also should be a text field, and we increase the length to 300. So with that we can enter more text here and be more descriptive on that. Save again. This time it's graphs. Okay. And the same is true for all the other tables. And I will just do that off screen. And now we have all the tables here. And we can look into, for example, individuals. And we have graph IDs, sex ID, age ID, orientation, completeness as floats, the last two. And then we have something like the C14 data with graph ID, lab number, BP, and standard deviation. And the artifacts with name, type ID, and material ID. And for the different lookup tables, for example, like ages, they all look the same. They have an ID and a name, and within that you can store the value list that we later like to use. Next thing, last thing for this video, now we have to define the relationships. I mean, the relationships between the data are already stored within the structure, within having, for example, in artifacts, material and type ID here, and this relates to types and materials. But we make our lives easier if we tell this to the database, to the base program already. And to this we can go to extras Beziehung, respectively tools and relationships. And if we open this dialog, we can see here some tables are already present, and we can also add more. So sites we have, graphs we have, individuals we have, C14 data, artifacts, sexes already there, ages, types, and materials. We can close this down. And now we can define the relationships. So sites, the ID, should relate to site ID. I just click, okay, I have to delete this one again. So I have to click there, and then I drag and drop this connection to site ID, and then we have a 1-to-n relationship here. And for individuals, we have graph ID, and this should go to ID of Graves. Then we have this connection here, and the same is true for artifacts. So there we have also Grave ID, and this connects to the ID of Graves. And then we have C14 dates, and there also the ID of Graves connects to Grave ID here. This is the one side, and now we connect here materials and types to the artifact. So ID of materials go to material ID, and ID of types go to type ID. And the same is done for the individuals here. Sex ID goes to sexes, and age ID goes to ages. And with that, we have predefined the structure of our data, and this will later be used if we create forms or make queries and want to have also represented sub-information there. Okay, this is the general setup of a database. In the next video, we will talk about creating forms and also specifying forms for hierarchical sub-things. So we start with the graves, and we want to have included sub-forms for individual artifacts and C14 dates, and we also want to select sites on the grave level easily by a drop-down field, and that's what I will show you later on.